you guys remember the last game of Dota 2 that the Sherdils played against the Yodhas? Well, let me remind you, the Sherdils massacred the Yodhas with a total of 48 kills against a meager 8. But let's not underestimate the Yodhas because now they know their opponent. Their only hope is this last game of Dota 2.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Ucypher League. My name is Vivek, with me is CloudX, and this is round robin number 2. The Yodhas, they managed to find their stride towards the end of round robin number 1. 11, he's really starting to find his groove on that 4 position, leading his team from the front. Let's see if the Yodhas can carry this forward. The Sherdils, I mean, the last time around they played, they ended up losing. It was a bit of a disappointment. Khans was good on the visage and all of that, but they just couldn't close the game. It's still a new patch. We're still discovering things as we go by. But one thing is for sure that the Yodhas are going to still ban out the Bat Rider, which Khans was phenomenal on earlier on in the tournament versus Yodhas themselves. Yep. Both the Bat Rider and the Monkey King.
No surprise that the Bat Rider gets banned out by Yodhas. They are worried about Khans. He's proven himself to be the most high impact player on the side of Sherdils time and time again. However, his Darkseer is still in the mix, and I wouldn't be surprised if they chose to pick it up as the first pick on the side of Sherdils.
I mean, even the Monkey King ban, it was the rival playing a one position Monkey King where he scored a rampage against the Yodhas.
Against the Yodhas themselves, exactly.
Yeah, last time around, I think the score was something like 40-8 and that game ended really, really soon.
But this is a different Yodhas that are coming into this game. I feel like they've really gotten their stride, they've found their momentum. And more than their momentum, it seems like they've found their leadership in 11.
Yeah.
His switch from the 5 position to the 4 position role has been immensely impactful in this tournament. And Yodhas have found themselves something that's working for them in the new patch. They'll open up with the Earthshaker pick. They banned out the Doom. This leads me to believe we're going to see a Medusa pick. Please don't ask us why. It doesn't make any sense in any universe in Dota, but Doom is considered to be a counter to the Medusa only in the Ucypher League by the players.
Yeah.
This is based on conversations over a cup of tea outside of the set.
Many cups of tea.
But Nyx Assassin 3rd ban coming out from Sherdils, that's something I can get behind. Mm-hmm. And they'll open with the Nightstalker pick. The most banned hero as of date on the international circuit. Sherdils going to snag them up for himself. Yeah, snag him up for themselves, I'm sorry.
I think we're going to see a rival Nightstalker and an Opa.
Rival Nightstalker, really?
A Disruption Nightstalker.
Disruption Nightstalker, yeah.
My bad. Opa's probably going to be playing the 5 position with the Shadow Shaman. I like this support duo. Someone to roam around. Someone who's a 5 who can also react and have some impact if his mid laner is gone upon.
I think the primary drawback with the Shadow Shaman is he's too squishy. You pick up...
Oh, man. Shit.
That's a hero I haven't seen in a long time. But while Sherdils are busy picking up the squishies, Yodhas are just going all in with the tankiness. The first Tidehunter pick of the Ucypher League, we haven't seen this hero being picked or banned for that matter, but Yodhas decided it's a good idea to second pick him here. Why?
Because when you press a button, the entire screen gets stunned. And a little more.
There's also no room for a Rubick anymore in Sherdils' lineup. If at all, they were banking on something like a Spell Steal. But given the new Ravage, I'm not even sure it's possible to Spell Steal anymore unless you blink in a little late.
I think you got to run a strong tri lane, pick something like the Ursa or the Lifestealer and just make life really difficult for the Tidehunter in the lane itself. Both can do exceptionally well versus the Tidehunter. And when you got the Shadow Shaman as a means of lockdown, you should be able to kill him multiple times in lane.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah.
But I mean, the Kraken Shell does dispel the shackles as well, if I'm not wrong. So
I'm not sure.
It does. I'm pretty sure it does.
Okay.
So
Early on, though.
I don't think that's a kill, actually. I think the Tidehunter is fairly secure in that lane. Unless...
Even with an Ursa or a Lifestealer?
Maybe not so much with an Ursa. I think he could deal with the Lifestealer. But yeah, I think the one hero that would really cause a lot of problems for this Tide would be a Juggernaut pick right now by Sherdils.
Okay.
I like the Juggernaut in this game, particularly because of the magic immunity versus that Ravage that's going to come out onto the battlefield. There's also the Healing Ward that works well in a push augmented by the Shadow Shaman. I still maintain that Juggernaut is a situational core, but this is a situation for the Jug. There it is. Sherdils go with their tried and tested Darkseer. Now they've got the duo with the Darkseer and the Nightstalker. Even if the Nightstalker can't make anything happen in the middle lane, It's very likely that he's just going to run up top to where the Darkseer is hanging about and try and score some kills over there.
I like the bans coming out from the Sherdils. They banned two of the not-so-pockety pocket strats that everybody at Ucypher is relying on, the Medusa and the Spectre. They want them to play Dota like the rest of the world does, and they're trying to force the Yodhas out of their comfort zone. So we're seeing a Shadow Demon pickup. This makes me wonder if we might see maybe an Invoker, maybe a Leshrac, something that works well with the Shadow Demon here.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind an Invoker pick, but I'm not entirely sold on the Shadow Demon and Earthshaker support combination. On one hand, you can get a fairly easy Fissure block with the Shadow Demon Disruption, but on the other hand, how are you going to keep the chase going with the Darkseer after the Shadow Demon gets the Disruption off? One Fissure Stun, sure, then he's just going to surge and try and get the hell away. If he's not entirely blocked out, he's going to get away from towards his tower, and if he's blocked out, he's probably going to run into the jungle. Theoretically, this should be a good lane for the Darkseer.
Yeah, I think he's going to be fine.
Yodhas, they've got themselves the fourth pick on the board, but before that, it's Sherdils that need to make a choice. What do they have up their sleeves? They're looking for a mid and a one position.
I'd like to see Mamacita play the puck. He's been good on that hero.
Oh.
But we're going to see the Storm Spirit.
Okay.
Now, I mean, my exposure to Dota outside Ucypher is kind of limited because of the hectic schedule that we're all running here. But I did manage to catch, Miracle play the Storm Spirit. Arcane Rune plus Kaya, he literally didn't lose mana. And he was zipping around just to reinforce that point and make it how obvious and imbalanced the Storm Spirit is with the Kaya. Midborn played the Storm Spirit. He excelled as well. And I think this is a good game for a Storm Spirit.
The thing about Storm is he's not the best laner in the middle lane. There's a lot of, quite a few heroes can take on the Storm Spirit in a one-on-one. And it's not like the Storm and the Nightstar could really have the best synergy, at least up until he's level 6.
Do you think we're looking at a co-op here from the others?
It's likely. I mean, I wouldn't put it past them.
Or a Tinker. They picked the Tinker in the past.
Honestly, I'm still a fan of your earlier suggestion of the Puck. I think versus...
For the Yodhas.
Yeah, for the Yodhas. I think the Puck wouldn't be half bad this time around. Oh, you actually suggested for Sherdils.
I suggested the Puck for Sherdils, but I'd like the Invoker now, actually. Because, I mean, if you're up against a Storm is a weak laner, you can pick a sort of weak laner yourself that adds a lot later on in the game.
Honestly, I don't think the Invoker is a weak laner at all. I think past the first three or four levels, I think the Invoker starts to take the cake in that lane quite comfortably. Mm-hmm. And Invoker is also one of those heroes that could be survivable versus the Nightstalker, especially if he comes into the lane without detection.
Yeah.
It's pretty unlikely that we'll see a Nightstalker running around the map with the Dust at the 4-minute mark. So Invoker should theoretically be safe for the most part. If he does invest into a Dust and he fails that gank, that's a lot. It's a bit more of an economic blow that he has to sustain for himself and for his teammates. Yodhas, if at all they go for the Invoker, it wouldn't be half bad. You've got the stuns coming out from the Shadow Demon and, well, the disruption coming out from the Shadow Demon for the Sunstrike. And towards the later stages as well, the synergy with the Tidehunter and that Invoker, a good Ravage into an EMP could work. But instead, they're going to go with the Venomancer, which I assume is going to be their mid.
Or could just be a safe lane Venomancer.
It's possible. Bloodseeker's still in the mix as well, so they could go for the Bloodseeker after this.
On the others?
Yeah.
Yeah, that'd be...
Then you have the option to interchange whether you want to run that Bloodseeker on the mid or you want to run the Veno on the mid. Either of those two could go to the safe lane as well. What's Sherdil's possible pickup here on the last pick? Lifesteal is in the mix, and they have...
So Lifesteal is magic immune as well.
Lifesteal is the best pick here for Sherdils, actually.
It's like a Juggernaut and the Blade Fury. Lifestealer is good. Poison Nova does go through Rage, but it's...
The Anchor Smash debuff is dispellable, if I'm not mistaken. So you can Rage out of it and go ham on the Tidehunter. It's also the Feast damage that's going to work a lot better versus that Strength tanky hero.
Yep.
So I'm a fan of the Lifestealer. There's also that obvious Infest Bomb that Sherdils could pull out.
Lifestealer is not banned, right? Yep.
Yeah. Anti-Mage gets banned out, and so too does the Juggernaut, which means that we could see a Medusa pick coming out. Oh, never mind. Medusa's actually banned out.
Last pick for Yodhas.
I want to say Bloodseeker. Safe lane Bloodseeker, mid Venomancer, and...
Yeah, they run it in the past. I mean, Kale played the Venomancer last time around, if I'm not mistaken. But they could switch things up. Kale might just be playing the Tire Hunter.
Yodhas, final pick on the board. Bloodseeker should be the pick here. Alternatively, they could go for...
What else?
Well, maybe a Lifestealer on their side wouldn't be half bad either. It's the Luna.
Okay.
So, the goal here seems to be the Shadow Demon Luna Illusion push, along with the Venom Plague Wards and the threat of a Ravage on the back lines. I like it. I think Yodhas have a strong push lineup, but I also like Sherdil's lineup at the same time, if only they continue to pick up that Lifestealer here. What is the other alternative? A Drow Ranger? I'm not a fan of the Terror Blade, no.
No.
Yeah, sorry, I'm just tunnel visioning now. I think that Lifestealer is by far the best choice here for them.
I'm just looking at other options. What else have you got?
Drow Ranger, if they want to do a Drow Storm Strat. But that's so risky given that there's
it's horrible. I mean, there's no way Drow escapes a Ravage or a Fisher. No. I'm going to go with the Sven.
It's the Sven, okay.
I like it in the sense that the Sven is self-sufficient versus the Tide.
Is he?
Give him a couple of levels, he's going to be hurting the Tide.
I think the Tide actually has the upper hand in that lane. Sven's going to go forward to farm. Tide Hunter walks in and smacks him with the Anchor Smash. Sands his ground and there's nothing that the Sven can do to him. Theoretically, I think the Tide has the upper hand in this lane.
I mean, Lifestealer would have certainly been better.
Yeah.
Or else...
Even a Lifestealer in a one-on-one struggles versus the Tide. The Sven really holds no candle to him. They have to try and score kills with the Sven, Shadow Shaman and the Nightstalker.
Yeah.
But that's a tall ask. Tide Hunter's just going to put that first point into the Kraken Shell and you basically can't stun lock him to death.
Do you think they could have gone for a Razor? Not a fan.
You mean the Yodhas or the Sherdils?
The Sherdils.
Not a fan of the Razor. Like I said, I've just tunnel visioned on that Lifestealer who I think could have been perfect.
Yeah, the Lifestealer would have been great. I also feel like to some extent the Lifestealer might have struggled versus a farm Luna later on.
Yeah, but that's where the Infest Bomb comes in, right? Yeah. You have the option to close the gap between you and Luna and then blow her up in that Electric Vortex stun.
And it's a very cheap Infest Bomb with the Storm Spirit.
Yeah, it's not like you got to wait for a Blink Tag or any such.
So there is a certain pressure of sorts for the Sherdils to have a strong mid-game and ensure that the Shadow Demon Luna push never really forms and starts becoming too much of an issue. It's also interesting to note that Yodhas has switched things up. If I'm not mistaken, Keel was their off-laner and he's now playing the one position. And Shandy's going to the off-lane. Huh. Okay, so another switch up in the Yodhas.
Some cheeky stuff actually, because we did see Kale running the offlane for the most part, right?
Yeah, I remember Kale playing Sand
King somewhere along the line. Yeah.
Versus the Shed, it's the last time around. So Yodhas, they're coming into round robin number two with a new plan, a renewed sense of purpose. Let's see if it can work for them. They do have ridiculously strong team fight.
And a ridiculously strong push as well.
Yeah.
The problem is though, Sherdils has that Wombo combo going for them with the Sven and the Darks here.
Yeah.
But that's really all they've got going for them in their defense. You miss a vacuum and you're not going to be able to hold your high ground efficiently. It's not like Yodhas needs to commit to a YOLO push either. They basically got to slowly push and chip away the buildings with the illusions and the plague wards and all that. Mm-hmm. Committing a vacuum will be difficult. Khans has a lot of pressure upon him this game.
It's also one of those games where soon enough you'll need a BKB on your Storm Spirit. Mm-hmm.
Mama Sita, he's definitely going to need that BKB eventually. There's just way too much control coming out on the side of Yodhas here. But I think it's going to be the Bloodstone first. No two questions about it. Unless he gets hammered entirely in the lane.
Have they paused the game to have a team talk?
The thing about the Sven though, right? We've seen a lot of teams are now starting to figure out how the Sven should be run. Instead of just having him farm away in the jungle and come out in the ultra late game stage, they're farming till they get an item, they fight with an item, then they go back to farming, get another item quickly, come back with another power spike and fight. That's how you play Sven. The problem with that is Yodhas can do the exact same thing with Luna because she farms equally fast, if not faster than rival on the Sven this game. theoretically, if it boils down to a farm war between the Sven and the Luna, I think the Luna gets a slight edge. There's also the fact that if you're looking at a 4 protect 1 draft, Yodhas has a fantastic 4-man pushing lineup as well. The threat of a Ravage, an Earthshaker behind to disengage, and then you've got the Venom Walls to be set up along with the Shadow Demon being a defensive layer.
Yeah, getting that accept on disruption is going to be crucial. That vision might still not be enough versus Shondi and the Tidehunter, but it's going to help them to some extent. They need as much help as possible because the team fight is just too strong on the side of the Yodhas.
The late game itemization as well, right? Yodhas has the Luna is one of those heroes that naturally does tend to build items like the Manta and the Butterfly. Mm-hmm. But the Sven doesn't normally build an MKB. If you build the Bloodthorn, the Manta is going to be available on the Luna to dispel it. Mm-hmm. And if you don't build the MKB, it's very likely that the Butterfly is not going to allow the Sven to dish out to his maximum damage potential. Mm-hmm. Same goes with the Storm Spirit. Not an MKB carrier, but might be forced to build one this game because the Bloodthorn may just not cut it. And even if you do manage to get all of that, you've got to worry about 11 standing behind with that defensive disruption at the ready. They've swapped things up again, though. 11's going to be playing the 5 instead of the 4, and Akme's taking up the 4 role on that Earthshaker.
Okay.
Unless we're looking at a 4 Tidehunter?
No, Akme and 11 are the 2 supports. You think 4 Tidehunter is a viable strat?
I'm not sure. It's been a while since we've seen a 4 position Tidehunter.
Was it ever viable?
Did teams
run it once upon a time?
Back when the Anchor Smash was a passive. That was a long time ago.
When was that?
A long, long time
ago. Dota 1?
I don't know if they changed that in Dota
1. I mean, Dota Anchor 1 Dota Smash 2, was that active in Dota 2 when I...
Yeah, but okay, yeah, I think
so this was... So Anchor Smash became an active... I'll tell you when. Do you remember when they changed Razor, Sven, Wipe, all those heroes? Those changes in Dota 1, the big patch. I don't know what it's called. But yeah, that's when Anchor Smash became an active. I remember everyone abusing it. Okay, my keyboard has died. What is going on?
Lovely. We're having keyboard issues.
Is it my keyboard? Is it my mouse? I'm just going to quickly reconnect.
Just Dota things. Oh, looks like mine's actually crashed as well. Did someone mess around with our lobby settings?
Not that I know of.
For some strange reason, I couldn't seem to move about with my camera as well.
Yeah, now it's working.
Just a Dota restart, fix it. You can call for the resume. You can get this game back.
Okay. Oh yeah, so Kale's back to the offlane. Just messing around with us, but 11 is still playing the 5 position for today.
11, yeah, we talked about that. 11's actually moved over to the 5. I'm wondering if this is the best idea, because the last time they did this with 11 playing the 5 versus Sherdils themselves, Yodhas ended up getting hammered. So this could be a bit of PTSD kicking in for 11 and his boys. But we're going to see a fairly peaceful start. Mama Sita's going to get the Bounty Rune on the Dire side. Apps will get it on the Raiden. They should both TP to their Tier 2 towers and get back in time for dinner to block their creep waves. Mm-hmm. Swapped. By the way, they swapped again. So Shondi took up the Luna after all.
Yeah, and Kale is going to the offlane.
I see. Opa starts off with just the Tangos and a TP. So he's clearly playing the 6 position role here, if ever there was such a thing. Meanwhile, Apps, Wraith Band, standard stuff, gets the range creep in the lane. That could help him pull ahead ever so slightly. Especially if he can get this deny on the Radiant range creep. Mm-hmm. Chose to start with the Venomous Gale. I don't know if that was necessary. A Poison Sting would have helped him zone out Mama Sita a bit more this early on. Anyway, looks like bottom they've gone in on Khans and done a fair bit of damage upon him.
Yeah, they got the Fisher. He's got a fair fire. He's just going to buy himself some time and keep Pac-Man 11 busy. So, Disruption as well as Opa, they moved in towards the enemy jungle. They didn't spot out the Tidehunter. It's a bit silly because neutrals do not spawn before the 1 minute mark and now they're searching in the trees. Kale senses this and just TP's back. Small victories here in the offlane.
Yeah, this is
I think it's this Radiant Observer that's giving him... It's this Radiant Observer that's giving him all that information.
Yeah, Kale's doing a good job so far. He's basically up to level 2 now and he's got a point in both the Anchor Smash and the Kraken Shell. They're going to try and make a play on him here with Opa coming
Storm
in.
Stormhammer, they have the Shackles. Do they have the damage though? 1 point in Warcry, 1 point in Stormhammer. I mean, they're hurting with all that magical damage, but yeah, 11 even cancels his own TP.
Yeah, so that went south for Sherdils because he got the Anchor Smash off on Rival. So throughout that entire stun duration, he took basically no damage from the Sven at least. Like I said, killing this Tidehunter is a Herculean task on this top lane.
The real winner so far in the laning phase is Mama Sita in the mid lane. He's more than double the CS of the Venomancer.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm not sure what Apps is doing wrong here.
I think it's the fact that he's prioritizing Venomous Gale over the Poison Sting when he could simply be harassing Mama Sita out of the lane with those auto attacks. But Mama Sita used a lot of his mana to farm over there. You can see him running low on fumes, which is probably going to start hurting him in just a bit because it means that Apps can start to dominate the lane slowly, especially if Mama Sita's denied this rune, and it looks like he has been denied the rune.
Yeah, they moved over and picked it up. The Earthshaker as well as the Shadow Demon.
No first blood just yet, 3 minutes in. Both teams playing passive Dota here. Acme on the Earthshaker. Does he want to make a rotation soon? He's got that TP scroll if he wants to counter gank. I think he should consider holding on to it for a potential gank on the middle lane or a counter gank on the top lane. Because the Fisher block, when they try to dive the tower under the Tidehunter, could be absolutely crucial. This early game for the Earthshaker, it's really about him keeping his eyes and ears open, right? Looking for opportunities across the map while still continuing to maintain equilibrium on the bottom lane and catch up on levels.
You know what, honestly, they've got a smoke, they can move mid and try and bring down the storm with those 2 points in Venomous Gale. A decent Fisher.
Yeah.
Man, the waves are at a nice place. Could result in a kill. They're going to try and Kale once more. They start out with the Void. This time the Anchor Smash not there upon the Sven. Kale not getting the opportunity to use it. He's got the Kraken Shell. He's been hexed, but this is forcing out TPs. Opa still draws first blood.
And Sherdils open the scoreboard. That was picture perfect coming out from Sherdils. They chained up their stuns perfectly.
Yeah.
Opa even put that 1 point into the hex, which prevented the Anchor Smash from coming out. Then the Tidehunter decided it's best to just ditch and run, but that was a mistake. If he took a millisecond out to pop the Anchor Smash and then continue to run, maybe he would have survived long enough for that Fisher to come in. But Rival, it's a little surprising that he chose not to pick up the Magic Stick versus the Tidehunter. You know for a fact he's going to be spamming those Anchor Smashes every given opportunity.
What's he picked up? He's picked up a Mango. Suddenly just rush the Mask of Madness.
Kale. He's not really getting too much farm in the lane. I mean, he's got 5 CS, but on the other side, the Darkseer seems to be doing a little bit better. He's at 8 CS himself.
He's level got three. His soul ring. This is when things look better for him.
There was a rotation towards mid by 11 as well, but they couldn't quite get the kill on Mama Sita. No disruption committed by the looks of it. He's also chosen not to put a single point into disruption, which seems like a mistake. He's gone 2 points in the Shadow Bird. He's solo smoked right now. Mama Sita's probably going to go down to Apps here. He has to TP out.
He just has to get the disruption. Oh, almost.
He'll dodge a bullet, but this delays his level 6 a bit more. And Apps is going to have the level 6 before the Storm Spirit now. Good thing, though, that the Night Stalker is moving towards the middle lane. He's not going to leave out on this free EXP. His first night, can't say it's been a wild success.
Solo smoke coming out though from 11, not really resulting in the kill that they were hoping for. They knew they had to kill the Storm Spirit before he hit 6. Unfortunately, they couldn't cancel his TP and...
Rival's thinking of going in on Kale once again. He's got the Storm Hammer available, 2 points in it in fact. But I think they're going to need that Night Stalker to join as well, because Tide's actually gotten a little tankier as well, with 3 points in the Kraken Shell available now and 2 in the Anchor Smash. Do we have the Magic Stick pickup yet? Nope, not just yet. Rival, I think he's made a bit of a mistake here, but not a very costly one. Mm-hmm. Cheeky disruption play, stealing that Bounty Rune away from the Tide Hunter, just giving him no quarter whatsoever. But he is up to level 5, and Khan's is still at level 4.
Has Khan got any stacks for himself?
No, looks like he hasn't.
No stacks for the Swen either, but mid lane disruption goes in. Mamacita, he's got the Ball Lightning. The infused raindrops are there on Abs. Who drops the poison? No one. Not sure he's going to get a kill. It's going to take a couple of rotations if they hope to find one in response. 11 comes in with the double damage rune. And
Mamacita could be dying here.
What? Yeah, he's actually... Nah, he's not going to.
No, that was too close. The Poison Nova doesn't do lethal damage and the Venomous Gale just barely wore off. I think he bottle charged in the middle of that to get like a milli, like a fraction of HP there.
Yeah.
Which allowed him to survive. Meanwhile, in the jungle, Khan's also just up to shenanigans. I think he stole another Bounty Rune there. No, he actually just walked in and walked out of the jungle. Possibly trying to farm any enemy neutral. 2-0 so far. That Venomancer death doesn't result in a counter kill, and Apps will continue to farm in the middle lane as if nothing happened. But the real farmer here is that Luna. Shondi's at 43 and 26 denies. He should be on top of the net worth charts as well. Indeed he is.
Yeah, both the Luna as well as the Swen are doing pretty much the same in terms of net worth.
I think the only difference is that the Swen has one assist and the Luna doesn't.
Yeah.
That's going to be the Sven's Mask of Madness, and that accelerates his farm rate quite significantly. Meanwhile, Luna's yet to get a point into the Glaives, which means that she's going to be farming slowly for the next couple of minutes as well. No stacks for the Sven in the jungle either, so... Well, there is one stack of Ancients. Mm-hmm.
Has Luna got any? Yeah, Luna has one stack as well. It's going to be a while before Luna can clear that stack. Quite peaceful early game. Sherdils get a couple of kills. One on the Tide, who's finding recovery in the jungle. He's hit level 6. He's got a mango as well as a TP. And now Sherdils have to, at least play with a little bit of caution, because the Tide Hunter could just TP in and pop a Ravage from a mile away.
Mid.
They go in, Earthshaker wanting to TP in, Abs dropping low. The infused raindrops do not keep him alive. And that Fisher, just a piece of decoration on the floor.
Acme reacted very quickly, but I think that was a delayed TP because the Venom might have just TP'd into the lane. I'm not entirely sure. But nonetheless, it was a tad bit too slow and he can't quite make the counter kill happen. That's the second time this has happened to the Venomancer, and that's a daytime Nightstalker that rotates in from behind and helps secure a kill.
Who's got to be doing the TPs then? Do you think 11 would be more...
11 should probably just hang back behind that Venomancer at this point.
Mm-hmm. He's hanging back behind Shondi. Now.
But it doesn't look like they're going for Shondi at all. They have that observer ward place for Shondi to play safe. Mm-hmm. Up top though.
Yeah, they want to dive the Tide Hunter. They've got to be careful. He's got the Ravage. They go in, but look at the control. The shackles were there, but look at this kill. Just turns around, pops the Ravage.
Why?
Where's his team? What's it going to accomplish?
That was the most pointless Ravage ever. Another tower is even going to end up going down by the looks of it.
Yeah, Rival has got strength for a bit as well as a Mask of Madness. So they're going to do some serious work onto this tower. Opa doesn't have the Mask Serpent Wars just yet. But it seems as if Luna as well as 11 and Acme are trying to do the same on the other edge of the map. The disruption onto the Darkseer. But here comes the Night Stalker. Goes in with the Crippling Fear and the Void. Shondi with the Eclipse. The Vacuum onto two. Mamacita. He's dropping low, but he's not yet been brought down. And he zips ahead and brings down 11. Another overcharge from his Remnant. Secures a kill on Acme. And they're moving on to Shondi. The call is Ace Kobe. And Shondi, where does he go from here? He has a TP in his backpack. The Ravage, Kale TP's in, but he's got no Ravage. What's he going to do? He's going to watch as his Luna falls, as Mamacita scores a triple
Apps
kill, but Apps on cleanup duty. He's got the Venomous Gale as well as the Poison Nova and a Haste Rune to boot. He secures one kill on the Night Stalker and Khans will surely go down. They're moving in for more disruption onto Mamacita, who's got a whole lot of money in that streak. He's eventually going to be bought down, and that's a dominating streak going over to the Tide Hunter.
Opa was the only survivor there and he barely gets away by the skin of his teeth. That fight went on for way too long and the chase was a bit too winding for that Luna. They got greedy. They set their sights on Shondi's one position Luna and they decided to go all in for that kill. But that gave them enough time to rotate in the Tidehunter to bring back the Venomancer, who I believe respawned and TP'd back. And of course, you had 11 coming in as well. Sorry, the Venomancer actually came in with the haste from the side,
Venomancer,
so he didn't
came
die.
Along with the haste from the big win though for Sherdils is that they killed the Luna and they didn't lose the Swen. And Swen got a tier 1.
Yeah, so I guess they've got something going for them at the very least. That's going to be a Yasha for Rival very soon, and his mobility just goes through the roof. No Blink Dagger pickup for him though. I would have liked to see an early Blink on him, but this is one of those games where he's going to need that BKB shortly after that Sanjin Yasha.
Yeah, he definitely needs a BKB. How soon is the question? Mama Sita's completed the Kaya.
Meanwhile, on bottom, Sherdils, knowing that a whole bunch of those big spells are on cooldown, they're just going to drop the Serpent Wands and make something happen on the tier 1.
I mean, Kale has the Ravage in 7. So they're grouping up mid and they're attempting to push themselves. Does Apps have the Plague Ward? No. This is hard but possible. The problem is that the Sherdils can TP right back to the mid lane. Yeah, so they're losing their tier 1 in the safe lane. They're hoping to get the dire tier 1 themselves. Have they got the glyph? Not yet. It is nighttime, so Disruption, he's moving with that increased movement speed. Do the Sherdils want to contest? Shondi is making his way towards the mid lane as well. It's just Disruption by himself. The mid tier 1, it seems as if the Sherdils are just going to give that up without any defense. But they get a tier 1 themselves.
And Kale gets the money for that, which means his mech is slightly closer now. Mm-hmm. Ravage is still available if they want to pop a smoke and go. 11 is holding on to one, but instead they're just going to bail. With Shondi moving bottom, his Mask of Madness being put to use to take out this creep wave. Khans, how's he looking in progress towards that mechanism? He's just got the Arcane Boots and about 200 gold right now. He's not at the best game.
No. I think Kale got that dominating streak on Mama Sita, if I'm not mistaken, and that's a lot of gold.
Was it Kale that got it? Yeah, it was Kale that got the dominating streak. 388 gold for that one kill.
That really sped up his farm, and that one tower helps as well. But Khan's got two towers for all purposes.
Well, we'll have to wait and see what Shondi goes for next. He has queued up the Dragonlance and the entire Hurricane Pike for now. Mobility versus the Swen seems like the way to go.
Yeah. Kite around the Swen as much as possible.
However, I think the Manta is a bit more priority here versus that Night Stalker.
Than the Hurricane Pike?
Yeah.
Well, they're just grouping up and pushing. Do the Sherdils want to defend? Or do they want to just continue making these trades? And trade they shall.
Khans wants to fight though. I mean, he's okay, never mind. He just wants to pick up a bounty rune and run.
Okay, he's just going to run away. Sherdils can keep pushing. They've committed the Mass Serpent Wards. They push harder and faster. This game is getting into a game of trades and spinning out of control very quickly.
Khans, is he going to get stopped here? Nope, Acme decides not to. They're going
Khans
back
could
to
cancel
defend
TPs.
This.
Is he watching for this? No, I don't think he knows. He could have gone for TPs and hope to cancel a couple of them. Kale goes in with a gush. They're trying to control Rival. They got the Demonic Purge, and this is certainly a death on Rival. He's out of position. He turns around, man fight.
Heavy commitments for that Swen, but totally worth it.
Yeah.
They defend their
tier 2. That's the first death on the Swen.
Yeah, I like the fact that Tide didn't hesitate to Ravage there. As long as you get the kill on the Swen, it's fine. Even if you get some collaterals on the sideline, it's okay. They knew that the Darkseer was not
mid
in that
lane,
fight.
Mama Sita is going in for Shondi all by himself. That Kale is good, but he takes an Eclipse and the mini stun from the Lucent Beam ensures is that Shondi has a salve. They can just keep pushing.
What was Mama Sita doing there? I mean, he just overestimated his abilities with that Kaya, decided to go in, tried to be the showstopper and make some flashy plays. We get that you're on TV, my friend, but please don't throw away your advantage to try and steal the limelight.
I mean, 11 needs to be careful. Acme walking in, looking for that Echo Slam, walking right back. Venomous Gale onto Disruption, they're trying to control him. Khans with the vacuum, catching only Apps. A quick Void coming out from Disruption to secure his retreat, and Kale caught in the shackles. But where's the damage? It's Khans with the Iron Shell and Rival from the backlines, who brings down 11. There's the Echo Slam, but Rival just just swipes him down. But the poison Nova upon all of them, along with the venomous gale, might ensure the death of Khans. They've controlled the Luna, and this time Mama Sita makes up. He's going forward for Appa. He's got the arcane boots. This should be a kill on the Venomancer. He's on a killing spree, courtesy the poison Nova. He managed to bring down Rival as well. If you take a look at the fight recap, four end up falling on the side of the Yodhas, while the Sherdils lose only the Swen and the Darks here.
Yeah, they're really overestimating what the Poison Nova can do. It's a level one Poison Nova. It's not as impactful as they think it is. It connected on a whole bunch of heroes along with the Venomous Gale, but a level one Poison Nova is not nearly enough to secure you the team fight victory there. Yeah. They also fought without the Eclipse on the Luna over
they
there.
They fought without the Eclipse, they fought without the Ravage.
They got the Echo Slam, but again, it was a bit underwhelming, I have to say. It's not a maxed out Aftershock either, so the stun lock wasn't there. And all this while Mama Sita was busy respawning and then TPing back into the fight.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, quite simply, they're not respecting their own cooldowns. They're a team with big cooldowns to work with. And without the Ravage, without that Eclipse, their team fight is missing a key source of damage.
They're also missing some of the basic items here. I'm kind of surprised that the Luna herself isn't carrying something like the Infused Raindrops. It really reduces the Storm Spirit's efficacy by a factor of two or so. But the fact that the Storm chose to go for the Kaya first instead of just rushing the Bloodstone implies that Mama Sita and his boys won a fight early on. It really boils down to whether or not you want to go for the cheap early game aggression sort of playstyle with the Kaya, or whether you want to go with the defensive, or rather you want to go with the more confident play of picking up a Bloodstone and then building the Kaya after. He's chosen to go with the Kaya, not entirely convinced that he's going to survive all of these fights, just happy as long as he can pump out the most amount of damage here. Mm-hmm. Mama Sita does have the Bloodstone queued up next, and Rival all the while is continuing to farm on the side. He's choosing to go for the Blink Dagger instead of the BKB. Not something I'm a big fan of here.
Sherdils undercover smoke. Yodhas undercover smoke. Who gets high ground matters a lot here. But Mama Sita's gone in upon Chandi. The disruption from 11 keeps him alive. And the demonic purge upon Rival means he's got a TP. But Kale is there with the Ravage. They've eliminated the Swen. They've kited him. But Khans with the vacuum wall. Kale says, I don't care. He pops his mech. He runs after Khans. And they've gone wild on stage. They're pushing back this Darkseer back to his own base. The Fisher is there. But they're not going to give chase. A Ravage for a Swen. Both teams coincidentally smoking at the same time.
That stupidly increased AoE on the Ravage though. He was aiming for the Swen, but he ended up catching both the Storm and the Shadow Shaman on the side, I believe.
Yeah.
So that prevented the re-engage coming out from them. What they're going to do though is immediately move towards the middle lane and at least find an objective on that Tier 2 tower.
They could do damage to the Tier 3. And Tier 3 is... Do they regen? No, they don't.
Nope. But yeah, no damage on the tier 3 right now. They are going to TP back. They're not really in a position to push Yodhas. But they were feeling fairly confident after the last team fight. I don't think Chandi should be completing this Hurricane Pike right now. This is probably a mistake.
You get
Manta style more than the BKB, in my opinion.
I think who picks up the first BKB here is going to have a huge impact in the next team fight.
I'd say that applies more so for Rival. Because he's going to have to get that BKB ASAP. He's getting controlled and brought down way too easily in these fights. And he's got to know that the BKB would prevent all of this from happening.
Yeah.
It's not like he's running slowly. He's got about 404 movement speed when he pops that Mask of Madness. And you could also pop the Walk Rider to get yourself a little more movement speed. So mobility shouldn't really be an issue for Rival.
The other issue, which is small but significant, is that the Darkseer is missing his mech. Well, the Tide has had his for the past two fights.
Mm-hmm.
And
but Darkseer's picked up the mech now, though.
Yeah, I mean, he's just picked it up. The past couple of fights, Kale had his up and going. He just shrugged off that vacuum wall and ran.
So, what's interesting is that on most occasions when Khans gets his Disruptor, there's usually some sort of synergy with him in the form of the support. You'd have something like a Disruptor, perhaps, with the Static Storm and the Dome going on top of it, or... you know, something along those lines. Unfortunately, this time, the only real follow-up to the vacuum in the wall is the Swen.
Yeah.
And it's pretty evident that the Swen is going to be the focus of all of their spells on the side of Yodhas. If Rival is being focused, and if he's brought down while he's being focused, the Darkseer can't quite get in and combo it up with the Swen either. Hmm. So it may not be the best lineup that they've picked up here. It's something that doesn't really play to their strengths. But for now, it looks like Sherdils are okay with continuing to trade towers. They do end up taking a tier 2 at the bottom lane by committing the Mass Serpent wards, while they sacrifice the tier 2 on the top. But now they're thinking of going up towards the base as well, but this could be a terrible idea.
Rival does have the gut strength. His blink, it's in the Korean. I think Sherdils are just going to back off. That's the right thing to do. Can they catch anyone on the retreat though? Shondi all by himself. This is when you need to be a hero, Mamacita. This is your moment on TV. Disruption's going to jump at the opportunity though. Flies over the trees, silences the Luna, and Mamacita zips in. They catch one on the retreat. It's Shondi. He'll just TP's back home.
Yeah, Shondi, did he try attempt a TP over there? I think he did. If he had the TP earlier on, he probably should have just popped it way earlier while the Night Stalker was trying to run in at him. But nonetheless, that does result in a very high value kill on the side of Sherdils. I really can't stress how important it was to pick up that Luna, because not only did they end up trading evenly in terms of towers, they ended up taking a one position for free over and above it. The kill, it went over the Rival, so Rival again gets a shot in the arm. That's his blink dagger now complete, and soon he'll have his BKB as well. So they're just dodging the fights till they get the BKB, looking for whatever trades and pickups they can in all the while. And the fact that they've managed to take down buildings alongside that Luna, or rather opposite that Luna, means that if they win a successful team fight, the Sven and his boys could just charge up onto the high ground, drop the serpent wards, and take a set of barracks. Opa just went all in, by the way. He's not even bothered putting a point in the Aether Shock. He's just gone for max Hex and Shackles.
It's unconventional, but I think it's going to pay dividends in these team fights if he manages to stay alive. He's inching closer and closer to his Glimmer Cape. I understand the pain of being 500 gold away from a Glimmer Cape, which could keep you alive, and then having to spend all of that in vision and detection. But what a perfect scan coming out from the Sherdils. They have read the Yodhas like a book. The question is, how do they choose to respond? They're just going to move further east away from them. Mamacita's got the Bloodstone, 14 charges on it now.
Yes, that's a freshly purchased Bloodstone as well. It's so pretty evident that Yodhas want to fight right now. They've got the threat of the Ravage, they've got a DD drone on the Luna. They've got a few aces up their sleeves, including Acme and that Blink Dagger.
They've got the Glyph. Do Sherdils want to fight? They're giving up their last tier 2. It's too late. I mean, now you fight high ground.
And now you've got to deal with the Luna illusions as well. I'm not sure why 11 hasn't made illusions out of him just yet.
I'm pretty sure he knows.
There you go. Hex.
They've got to control this Tidehunter. The Shackles are there, but who's going to do the damage? Rival pops his Godson. They've gone in on the back. They won the Shadow Demon, but look at that. Acme with the Echo Slam. There's the Ravage. It catches 2. It catches 3. It catches goddamn all of them. And Sherdils, they're on the retreat. They've lost the Storm Spirit. He's going to respawn quickly because, well, he's got 14 Bloodstone charges. Khan surges in. Doesn't get the Vacuum Wall. He's being controlled. And Shondi goes in aggressively. The Vacuum Wall is there. But you said this. Where's the follow-up in the goddamn draft? Mamacita zips in. An immediate disruption. Mamacita zips right back. And Opa with the Shackles. Well, without a Sven to follow up, those Sherdils, Shackles are meaningless.
They're just murdering. Yodhas are just murdering Sherdils in their base here. And they're going for the tier 3. This could be all she wrote for them. Their tier 3 does crumble. And now they might even get a lane of barracks. Shondi, he's getting richer by the minute. The glaives, they're just ripping apart Opa on the back lines. This will be barracks opening up the game for Yodhas. Now, will they be able to secure a clean retreat? That's the question on everyone's mind here. No mechanism for the Tidehunter. The zip forward aggressively from Mamacita, but he can't find anyone on the retreat.
I mean, Sherdils have got to find them on the retreat, in fact. All the big spells are on cooldown.
All of that was because of Acme and that Echo Slam. Catching 2 on the sidelines, setting up for the Eclipse into the Tidehunter Ravage. Beautiful stuff coming out from them.
I mean, that's one of the strengths of the team fight, right? I mean, if you jump the Luna, you got to worry about a disruption. If you show yourself anywhere on the map, you got to worry about a Ravage. And if you jump the Shadow Demon, Acme's got you covered. That was a beautiful Echo Slam, keeping the Shadow Demon alive, allowing that push to sustain, and Kale followed up with the Ravage.
There's a major power struggle now opening up at Ucypher, because the last time these two teams faced off, Sherdils basically massacred Yodhas. 48 kills by the end of the game. They were just playing with their food and toying with their opponents. And now, suddenly, Sherdils are the ones defending with a lane of Mega Creeps up against them, or rather with a Melee Barrack taken out up against them, and no casualties on the side of Yodhas throughout that entire fight. A BKB is complete on Shondi. He's got that extra layer of protection now coming his way, and the BKB on Rival is still slowly being built up. Roshan should probably be the next move coming out from Yodhas as soon as the Ravage and the Echo Slam come online, and that should be in the next 20 seconds.
But, I mean, one key item that could, I mean, I'm just being optimistic, it could possibly change the outcome of the next fight for the Sherdils is that BKB on Rival. He's 400 gold short of it, and he's desperately trying to farm it up, moving from camp to camp, bounty rune to bounty rune.
I'm also not a fan of Shondi getting the BKB this early on. He's lacking in the damage department, and he's lacking in the pushing potential department. Because honestly, the plan with a Shadow Demon Luna should have been just to spawn like multiple illusions, send a set of Manta illusions up onto the high ground as well, and basically take buildings. If they come in to jump you, you have the Earthshake and the Titan counter initiate.
Acme has gone in, the control is there, the Echo Slam unloaded. Beautifully done by Acme.
That's another set of Bloodstone charges shaved off of him.
Yeah, he dropped from 14 to 6 Bloodstone charges.
Smart decision coming out from them. They're not just barreling down a lane or going high ground. They're going to take Roshan instead. We're seeing Venomancer now finding Opa out here by himself. He's sitting with the Shadow Amulet in this very same spot. They're just going to let him go.
I mean, there's a Plague Ward waiting for
Opa. Is he going to die here?
Okay, I'm going to get back to the Rosh Pit. Rival, he's popped his BKB. He's managed to bring down the Shadow Demon, if I'm not mistaken, as well as the Earthshaker. Sherdils showing some signs of life while Opa just dies to the Plague Wards.
They spent so
much time... they're going to get Roshan.
They spent so much time dealing with that Shadow Shaman on the back lines. He ended up dying, sure, but now they get two kills in the pit and a Roshan on top of it. This is a shot in the arm for Sherdils. Finally, they get themselves an Aegis. The Aegis goes over to Mamacita, who's been focused time and again. And Sven's going to come in. He actually has that BKB, but he's now going to come in with some progress towards that Assault Cuirass as well. Are we seeing the tides of battle turn here? Because the Sven is once again on top of the net worth charts.
I mean, if you take a look at the net worth chart for this game altogether, the deficit has just been flatlining at like 2,000 gold. For the entirety of the game, nobody's really taken the lead. The only thing is, Yodhas have a lane of barracks to show for. But look at this, Sherdils, they picked up BKBs. Mm. They've given over Aegis to the Storm, which is a devastating force to reckon. I mean, you throw all your ultimates on him, he just respawns and kills you all over again. And,
One of the major issues here is that even though they've got a lane of Mega Creeps going up against, a lane of Super Creeps going up against Sherdils, Sven is great at just carving those creeps up and pushing the lane as if they weren't stronger.
Yeah.
It's not really that troublesome for Sherdils to play versus one lane of barracks down. It's also a bit of urgency that we're now seeing from Shondi and the boys coming out. So Shondi's not even going for the Manta style here. This is such a terrible move coming out from him. He's just rushing the butterfly.
Huh. I think the plan is to send for the illusions and slow siege with the
Which
illusion.
Is why you want to have Manta illusions on top of the Shadow Demon illusions. I just don't get it. Is it because of the cleave? Are they worried that the cleave is going to get rid of the illusions? That doesn't really make sense. There is such a thing as playing too defensively as well, because Luna, by virtue of her skill set, isn't the highest in the DPS department. You want to have some sort of damage items, and the BKB really doesn't help too much in that department. She's got Mask of Madness for attack speed, she's got BKB for survivability, but where's the sieging potential going to come from? Shadow Demon illusions? Sure, but those have a cooldown, and those are just two illusions that could be dealt with one with a Hex, and the other possibly with just right clicks. Mm-hmm.
Nova, and then you have to TP away.
He got picked today.
Pike and 1700 HP. There's no way he kills him by himself.
So in the new meta of Dota 2, that's one guy who gets banned a lot. A lot of teams want to keep him out of the game. Don't want to play him because having the advantage of that hero against five others, it's very overpowered.
So how could the Yodhas allow that? Like, isn't this a crazy advantage for the Sherdils? Just one hero?
I'm guessing the Yodhas have their own strategy, their own combination of heroes to silence him. And I'm pretty sure that's what they did.
No, so you're saying he's not unstoppable?
He's obviously not unstoppable. None of the heroes are.
What can stop him?
That gives him the daytime. Over to
if it's day, his powers are not as enhanced, not as strong as it used to be.
Like the name suggests.
Yep. To the max.
Am I? But I mean, you think this was a smart move by Mamacita's team?
But yeah, definitely. They spend this time trying to farm a BKB on the top.
Does
Mamacita pick up his BKB on
the top? This would be silly for Shanti to go up into the high ground with his teammates versus two out of three components for his butterfly.
And to add to that, the opposition, the Yodhas have this hero called Luna. Again, her third power is very enhanced in the night.
She's a night queen.
What the fuck is her name? No, I just, that's what I want to say.
Is going to make a return.
Sorry.
What do you want?
That's a full butterfly finally.
So,
okay.
In the opposition have taken Luna, who...
Say
okay, this on the side, rivals in disruption, trying to go in, Kale.
Yeah,
rival goes
Moonlight.
In, the vacuum catches only Moonlight. One,
that third power attacks people faster in the night.
Damage, turns that's around, what I want to say. Poison Nova, disruption in the midst of battle. No one falls just yet, while Chandi brings down, commands the damage. Catches a bunch of them.
All right, I'll say that again. I'll say that again.
The Darkseer will fall as well, and they jump in with the Enchanted Rim to bring down Opa. Rival buys back, wants to hold on to his base. Maybe now's the time to fight the Ravage on cooldown. The Echo Slam committed.
Luna got third power
go
now.
In Sherdils. The vacuum on cooldown. Mamacita just zips him blind. Pops his BKB.
Wants you told me Luna got rat me that attack speed becomes faster.
There's not real follow up.
Movement speed
and
damage.
He's finally going to bring him down, but Khan just taken a hit. Shandi, he's being controlled, but
what?
He doesn't get. Nobody's really focusing him. He turns around, brings down disruption, and he's going to bring down the barracks as well.
Okay,
this
cool.
Is GG.
Let's go.
That was three buybacks coming out on the side of the Dio. They end up dying back on the Nightstalker. They've lost the Dark Seer.
So the Yodhas
well,
have this hero called Luna.
This looks like it's going to be three days of backs. Mamacita with a desperate attempt. He goes in, but he gets stunned locked here. He's going to try and zip forward and backward, going for active with a disruption. Keeps him alive while Rival, he's on the wrong side of the fissure. Opa TP's out into no man's land. And once again, it looks like Yodhas will continue what they started. Moving towards the bottom lane where they look to take the final tier 3. But watch for Rival, the BKB, the Godstrength. They're both back online. He's thinking of going in. He jumps forward. He's going in for the bloody Shadow Demon of all the heroes, who turns and demonic purges him. Even 11 refuses to die here. Finally, he ends up going down. Well, Shandi says, to hell with you, sir. I'm just going to hit you with my Hurricane Pike and take your buildings in your face. This is it. Mega Creeps coming up versus Sherdils as Rival is still being controlled by a mere Tidehunter on the front lines. Mamacita, just an ornamental piece here on the battlefield, who gets stunned and brought down once again. Three down on the side of Sherdils. It's Mega Creeps versus them. And soon, we should see the double G's dropping.
I mean, Khan's is vacuum. It's free to look at, but it's not accomplishing too much. The wall dropped as well. Rival is the one running right back. Shandi, he's killing his own illusions, and he's moving on to the last tier 4. The Sherdils, they're fighting till the bitter end. But there's no way they deal with this Luna. Rival goes in. He's not got any true strike. The Echo Slam is there from Acme. It catches two. This might be another death of Rival. Shandi with the Hurricane Pike moves forward and loads the Eclipse. And Khan's doesn't have the surge. He's going to be controlled. He's going to be brought down. It's the monster kill streak for Shandi. Opa's there with the shackles. Mamacita respawns in three. But the double G's have been called. The Yodhas have done it. They've taken revenge for round robin number one. And they are your winners today in the Ucypher Season 1. What a game.
What an absolute baller game. Yodhas playing some really good ball. They have, as a team, they've taken revenge.